stars stay well. The morning sun was dead. The savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us. The weight of every curse upon him.
We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. Welcome, church, wherever you're joining us. Come on, we're just going to worship the King of Kings. Lift up your voice today. Open up your heart. Come on, let's sing.
Where two or more are gathered in His name, He is there. Oh, for all who come, who run to Him in faith, He is there.
Come on, lift your voice.
'Cause there is power in the name of Jesus. There is power, power in His name. There is power in the name of Jesus.
And sing, come on.
Faithful you are forever you. promises are yes and amen. All your promises are yes and amen. Come on, worship the Lord right now. Give him all the glory. Give him all the praise. He is a faithful God. Come on, let's worship Jesus.
Beautiful Savior.
Promises. Name it's yours, yeah.
So we see,
now we stand at the water's end.
Come on, sing.
Our eyes fixed on you,
Jesus,
as you go before us.
All
doubt is removed. You're the God of impossible, and you break down these walls. Hear the Spirit cry out. The battle is the Lord's. Oh, it's all yours.
Father, we thank you as we gather under the sound of your voice, under the declaration of your name, as we worship together, singing the battle is the Lord's. Today, we enforce that our victory comes from you, that we don't need to look at the giants we face, the obstacles that come against us, but that we are able to lean in, let your word wash over us, and allow the ministry of Jesus to cleanse and work in our lives. We thank you, Jesus, for what you're going to do in our hearts, in our lives, in every single person's life that is listening today, that they will be touched and changed forever. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So we're so excited today. We're gathering for part four of our Joshua series. Today we're talking all about the Battle of Jericho, and we're going to liken that to the battle that we have for our promised land. The promised land is mentioned in the New Testament, and we are to enter our promised land. God has given us a land with fulfilled promises for us. And that is where the enemy sets up his city. The enemy never positions himself in the wilderness, because in the wilderness, the people of Israel, the people of the Lord, and in today, you could say believers in Jesus in the wilderness, they're lost. They're of no effect. They're not doing anything. They're not a threat on anyone. You know, being a believer in Jesus, but not acting as a believer in Jesus is not a threat to the enemy. Just knowing Jesus is not a threat to the enemy, because when you start to activate your knowledge of Jesus, in other words, act upon your faith in Jesus, where you start to share your testimony, where you start to pray over people, where you start to actually act in response to the gospel, then you're a threat, because now you start to take ground. Now you start to reach others. Now you start to build the bride of Christ, and the church grows in its momentum and more people come to know Jesus. So the enemy hates it when believers act in response to the gospel and start to move towards their promised land. We've learned that over the past few weeks, movement in response to the gospel, in other words, a yes and an action, is when you start to actually move towards your promised land and you start to become a threat to the enemy. Now, the enemy always sets up camp in your promised land. He wants to stop you from entering the promised land, because in the promised land, you reign, you rule, you move from that place. So we're going to go into Joshua chapter 5. We're going to read together, because there's something I need to highlight. They've just crossed the Jordan. And as a church, we learned last week, crossing the Jordan is the spirit in response to following the ark, saying yes to the impossible, saying yes to where God is leading us. And it says, you've never been this way before. It's not about a life that's predictable, a life that's the same. It's about the adventure of walking with Jesus, the adventure of being a part of the bride of Christ. And so now they've seen this miracle. The waters have receded all the way back to the city of Adam. They've crossed the Jordan as a nation, and they're camped just outside their promised land city, the city of Jericho. And as they're camped there in Joshua chapter 5, Joshua has a infamous, in other words, a hugely significant encounter, right? And I want to highlight that to you, because it sets up the tone for the following battle at Jericho to be spirit-led, that Joshua steps into a spiritual victory realm, that he recognizes the power pattern of heaven, the pattern of Almighty God that releases the supernatural hand of God in every fight, in every battle. I want to tell you something today. You don't know how to fight a battle for yourself. You cannot conquer the devil for yourself. You cannot conquer all the spiritual principalities and powers on this earth. In your own strength, you will fall prey. You will fall victim. You will lose. So it's so important that we as believers in Jesus as our God, we go to Jesus and we look to the word for how to fight. Don't ever try fighting your flesh. Don't ever try fight by your smarts or your own mind. You'll lose. You'll lose badly. So Joshua has an encounter that sets up the tone for the whole battle at Jericho in order for him to not only have victory in himself, but he has to lead the leaders and the nations. So the more responsibility you have, the more you grow in life. Now, maybe you get married and you have kids. Now you have a responsibility over that home. Maybe you're leading in the workplace. You have responsibility over people. So you being led is just as significant as you being a leader. If you cannot be led by the Lord, you cannot lead others into the promised land. So Joshua in chapter 5, right, verse 13, it comes to pass when Joshua is by Jericho, he lifts his eyes and he looks and behold, a man stood opposite him with a sword drawn in his hand. And he recognizes this is a representation of God's battle, God's army, God's strength, right? And Joshua says, right, to this angelic being, are you for us or are you for our enemy? In other words, he sees this angel, this mighty warrior, this man standing with the sword, and he says, Lord, whose side are you on? And that's the question people often ask in life. Whose side is God on? Can I tell you? The response of the Lord is so interesting because God does not say I'm on their side or your side or his side or her side, right? Their side. God is not on a people group's side. God is not on a language's side, a country's side. No, God's response is neither. I'm not on anybody's side here. I'm on my own side. I am on the side of the Lord. Something that we really need to grasp in our spirits is before every battle for promised land territory, we need to recognize where is the Lord on this situation. When you fight with someone, do you say they must apologize? They must say sorry? Because, you know, God, I've been wronged. You're on my side. I've been wronged. No, the Lord says you forgive. You walk in love. That's the side God is on. When you walk in love, you walk in power. When you walk in submission, you walk in power. Why? Because you're not submitted to a person. You're submitted to the Lord. Even in your relationships, right? The Bible tells us to submit to one another. Do you know that's the hardest thing to do? Because that is literally where the Lord is released. Are you looking to your spouse to earn your trust, earn your love, earn the right to have an opinion? Or are you saying, Lord, I submit to you. I make you big and therefore I will honor and I will walk and I will respect, right? Even in life, we get into situations, you know, even in my own life, it's like, God, I feel called to start a church. But the interesting thing is I had my own plans on how that was going to go. And when I stepped out to start my own church, I found ourselves starting Redemption and we're like, this isn't what we planned. This is God, whose side are you on? God's answer is always neither. I'm not on anyone's side. I'm on my own side. See, so either you are going to apply the word of the Lord in your life in order to see his hand, or you're going to walk in your own rebellion and pride and not see his hand. God is not asking you to literally enforce your own agenda. He's saying, surrender to mine. So whenever we come into a battle for promised land, we first need this revelation, because at the end of this exchange, you know what happens? Joshua says, God, your servant is here. Tell me what I must do. Tell me what you would say to me. And God's response is, take your sandals off your feet. The ground you stand is holy. In other words, this is a moment with me, and literally let it be about how big God is. Worship me. Allow your eyes and yourself and your being to be consumed with me. Not yourself, not your problem, not your plans, me. The best thing we can ever do is just worship God. In other words, make him big. be in awe of the fact that he is God, rather than coming to him with, this is my plan, this is my problem, this is what I need. No, 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 you're God. And that's more important than anything else. My Lord is on his own side, and he will establish his church. He will build our lives. He will bring us into victory, but never think it is us and our agenda. So often when we're operating out of hurt, when we're operating in response to something, we come with our agenda to the Lord. That's okay, but that's the flesh. And in that exchange with the Lord, as we worship him, we realize, wow, I've actually been coming from the flesh. I don't want that person to suffer. I actually need to pray, love, sow into that person. I actually need to surrender. I need to say sorry. I need to forgive. I need to repent. And we start to fill ourselves with God is God, and we start to align with his word, align with his instruction for our lives. God, where's my financial breakthrough? Why have I not had this? Why have I not had that? Why have I not had this? What about my business? What about my profits? What about this? Whose side are you on? Neither. I'm here to build my church. Well, what are you going to do? No, the question is, what are you going to do? Well, in truth, God, I actually haven't been bringing my business to you, bringing my calling to you, and saying, you're God. It's your business. It's your life. And it's in that where we humble and we say, it's not about us. Pride literally just says, I'll take the place of God. I'll fight this enemy. You know, we even see that. Peter, I'll be the last one standing. Lord, if everybody disappears from you, Jesus, I'll be standing with you. Really, Peter? Let me tell you how strong you are on your own strength, my friend. In the next 24 hours, you're going to deny me 3 times. You will be the biggest failure of all the followers of Jesus in this moment. When you stand in your own strength, you crumble, you fall. So Joshua gets this huge lesson here. Don't ask God whose side he's on. Ask yourself, am I on his side? In other words, have I lined up with what he would want for me? Don't go to the Lord, hey, Lord, bless my relationship with this person. I want to date them. You should say to the Lord, you bring me the person. Let it be surrendered to you. It's not our agenda. Trusting that he's God allows him to move in his strength, giving him his place. Lord, it's all you. Right? So that happens in Joshua chapter 5. And now Joshua is teachable, is leadable. Now that God has said, Joshua, it's not about me being on your side or on their side. The question is, are you on my side? And so in this moment, now Joshua goes in chapter 6, verse 1. Joshua sees that Jericho is surely shut up because the children of Israel are there. So now the enemy is getting ready for battle. They've locked up the city, right? And the Lord says to Joshua, see, I have given Jericho into your hand. Let me ask you this question. Did they have Jericho already? No. They had no possession of Jericho. He has to see with the spiritual eye the land that God has already given him. God says, I have given it. Not I will give. I have given it. The promised land is yours. Are you prepared to act on that promise? God doesn't say it will be yours. He says it is yours. Right? And even so, God says, even the king and its mighty men, not its weak men, this powerful city will be yours. So God says to Joshua, march you and your men all around the city, right? Once. And you're going to do this for 6 days. So you and the people will march around, right? Every day for 6 days. You will take the 7 priests. They'll bear the 7 trumpets of ram's horns in front of the ark. On the 7th day, you shall march around the city 7 times. So once a day for 6 days, then you must take the 7 priests. They will go in front of the ark, all carrying trumpets of ram's horns. We'll talk about this now. And then on the 7th day, you must march 7 times. And it will come to pass that then you will make a long blast with the ram's horns. And when you hear the sound of the ram's trumpets, all the people will shout with a great shout, and the city will fall down flat. The walls will come down, and you will go up and you will enter. So Joshua says to the people, take up the Ark of the Covenant, take the 7 priests carrying 7 trumpets, 1 trumpet each before the Ark of the Lord. And he says to the people, proceed and march around the city and let him who is armed advance before the Ark of the Lord. In other words, battle army goes in front. And when it was that Joshua had spoken to the people, and he says to the 7 priests carrying the 7 trumpets all to advance and go, and they do so. The armed men go before the priests who blow the trumpet, as the rear guard after the ark, and while the priests continue blowing the trumpet. Now Joshua commanded the people, saying, "You shall not make any noise with your voice, nor shall a word proceed out of your mouth until I say, shout. Then you shout." Okay, so let's summarize. Right? We're going to go around the city 6 times. 1 time a day for 6 days. While we're going around, we're going to have our priests in front of the ark with ram's horns, and each priest, 7 priests. And on the 7th day, we will go around 7 times, and then the 7 priests will blow the trumpet sound. And when they blow the trumpet sound, only then can you, the people, shout. Until then, say nothing. So for 6 days, 6 times around, nothing gets said by the people. And on the 7th day, the 7th time, on the 7th day, we'll blast, we'll blow, and the city will be given to us. The walls will come down. Right. So Joshua gets told, God's not on any human being's side. He's on his own side, his own work's side. And now as we go in, I have specific instruction. Interestingly, the priests have to go in front of the ark, right? And they blow on ram's trumpets. Now the ram's horn comes by the death of a ram. So we know that this is a picture of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Even when Abraham takes Isaac up the mountain, he says, hey, the Lord will provide for himself a sacrifice. And when he was about to kill Isaac, God says, stop, withhold your knife. I have provided a ram. He looks and he sees a ram caught in the thorns by its horns. You can only get a ram's horn once you have killed the ram. So the gospel of Jesus Christ given to us, the proclamation of the gospel, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it alone is the power unto salvation for all who believe, Jew and Gentile. The gospel of Jesus Christ comes to us at the death and the resurrection of our ram provided unto us. So the priesthood carries the gospel of Jesus, not the gospel of themselves. Pastors often preach life skills and self-motivations and we are gonna. And I'm telling you, but we must be so careful that our thoughts often go above Jesus in a sermon. Always point people to the finished work of Jesus. He alone is the power unto salvation for all who believe. We as the priesthood must carry that ram's horn that comes at the sacrifice of heaven's most prized possession, the Son of God. And we must declare it, right? Declare it over the people. Declare it towards our enemy. When you speak to the devil and you say, in the name of myself, leave, he laughs at you. Oh, I'm telling you, devil, leave me alone. He doesn't listen. But when you say, in the name of Jesus, right, you will. In the name of Jesus, I am. In the name of Jesus, now you start to lift up the gospel and declare it. Okay? Interestingly, Joshua has another instruction for the people, which is to follow the leadership, the instruction. You know, when God sets leadership in church, it's not because he's trying to make a man great. He wants people to be led, right, by the Lord. He wants us to demonstrate that we're not submitted unto each other because each other earns each other's respect. No, we trust the Lord with our leadership. We trust the Lord with where he's taking us. We trust the Lord with whom he sets us in, which family, which church. And we say, God, I'm not here serving a man. I'm here serving the man. The Lord is my Lord. I'm not on his side or their side. I'm on God's side. And so Joshua set strict instructions for the people. So they had to listen. And there's a purpose for it. He tells them, God says, don't say anything until the 7th time on the 7th day. Why? Because can you imagine what people would have said? Your mouth is so powerful, but so often the devil gets into your thought life and then he starts to control your speaking life, and your speaking life has power. So what would have happened? If Joshua didn't tell the people, you say nothing until the time I tell you to shout in response to the blowing of the horns, what would have happened? This is what would have happened. Hey, bud. This is crazy. We're walking around here. Joshua's up front. People are there. Look at this wall. Look at these people. Look at that army. Here we are walking around. How is this a battle plan? God, can you just tell me, friend, like how on earth, what do you think about this? Here we're walking. We don't have arrows. We don't have cannons. How are we going to take on Jericho? Jericho is meters and meters high. And you know, an army perched up high, they just have to shoot. They can throw rocks. They can kill you so easily. What would have happened? Doubt would have become the atmosphere of the nation, because the devil would have started throwing thoughts into them. How can you win this? How can you defeat this mighty army? You know, God even says to Joshua, the king and his mighty men of valor. So they would have all walked around going, blowing a trumpet, giving a shout of praise. That's no strategy, Joshua. And what would have crept in? Cynicism and doubt, which would have started to create disunity in the nation. Lack of faith, lack of belief, right? Lack of belief that God was going to give them the land. Lack of belief that they possessed the promised land. And when God says to Joshua, I have given you the promised land, right? The people could have still spoken and said, it's not ours. This is not a plan. Walking around 6 days, what a waste of time. Nothing's happened. This is not a plan, right? So often in life, when God sets vision and a promised land over you, right? What will the devil come with? Sowing this cynicism, this doubt, this unbelief. We've got to be so careful how we speak in response to the thoughts that come into our mind. And you know what? It's okay to have those thoughts, but it's not okay to always be uttering them out. The complaining, the murmuring, it was such an issue in the nation of Israel, and it's still an issue in people's lives because we speak, oh, how is this a plan? How is the church going to solve? How are we going to do anything? This isn't working. This isn't going to do this. What about this? What about that? What about this? Well, you know what happens? You take yourself off of the side of God. You actually remove yourself from being on God's side when you start to operate with a different spirit, the cynical spirit. So we've got to be so careful there. It's okay. We're going to have those thoughts because the devil's going to throw those thoughts. Even me, I'm like, how could you even preach about this? How could you even declare this? You're just a frail man. You're just a guy in South Africa. How's a church going to change the world for the gospel of grace? And you know what? I don't want to speak those thoughts into being because they're not in line with the promises of God. So we act, we obey, we walk. And when the priesthood on the seventh day, after the seventh time, Joshua turns, right? So he had the ark of the Lord circle the city, go around it once. They came to the place they lodged. Early in the morning, they rise. They do it for the second, the third, the fourth, the fifth, the sixth. And in verse 16, it says, the seventh time it happened when the priests on the seventh day had gone around the city, Joshua now says to the people, shout, for the Lord God will give, no, has given you the city. The Lord God has given you the city. So you shout in response to the faith that the ground is already yours. Okay, I said all that to say this. Why seven? Why seven times seventh day? In Genesis chapter 2, we see that for 6 days, God is working, God is creating, and on the seventh day, God rests. On the seventh day, God rests. In Jewish faith, they call it the Sabbath. It means you are on the sixth day, you cease, and for the seventh day, you rest from work, right? In Hebrews chapter 4, verses 1, Paul writes and he says, therefore, since a promise remains of entering the rest of God, so there is a rest that is given by God, and there is a promise that that rest is for ours to enter into. Do you know Paul is not talking about rest as in just taking a break? He's talking about calling rest the city of Jericho. When God describes the promised land, he doesn't call it Jericho. He calls it my rest. That is the name given to the promised land. So it is a promise, not just for the people at the time of Joshua. It is a promise for us, the people following our heavenly Yeshua, right? And he says, let us fear lest any of you seem to have come short of it. So in other words, there are people who will not enter rest. And Paul does not say fear failing, fear sin. He actually only gives a fear to one thing. He says, fear not entering rest. In other words, missing out on the promises God has for you. For indeed, the gospel was preached to us as well as to them. He's talking about Jewish people, but the word which they heard did not profit them because it was not mixed with faith in those who heard it. We can declare the gospel of the finished work of Jesus over people all day long, but until you respond with a yes spirit in faith, you won't enter rest. because you'll always see the obstacle. You'll always see the giant. You'll always see what there is to be cynical about. And Paul says, fear missing this, beloved. Fear missing out on the rest God has for you. Right? What's so interesting about this is he literally says in verse 11, we have to work at entering this rest. In other words, he says, be diligent, labor. In other words, this is our work, is entering the rest of God. And here's what's fascinating. I believe fully God does it on the seventh day, the seventh time, because he's highlighting the number of completion and rest, saying that it is entering into the battle is about entering into the rest of God by faith in response to his declaration. I've given you this land. It's already yours. In other words, Jesus hung on the cross and he takes all sin, all sickness, all shame, and he declares, it is finished. It is a declaration of saying, I have purchased this rest for you. In Hebrews chapter 4, verses 8, before he talks about entering rest as a labor, in other words, something we need to be consciously doing, he actually says, if Joshua had given them rest, he would not have spoken afterward of a day to come. In other words, Joshua took the nation of Israel, yes, into a theoretical, literal promised land, but that was a picture of what our heavenly Yeshua was still to do for all, to enter into rest where you eat food you never sowed, live in homes you haven't built. In other words, enter into the work God has done for you. 777. The finished work. The seven blasts, the seven trumpets blowing out, right? After the seventh time on the seventh day, completion, finished, rest. So the battle being the Lord's is we literally by faith, not in ourselves. We say, I've got to get on God's side. But when I'm on God's side, when I'm declaring the work of Jesus, being on God's side is not about your works. It's about receiving his work as being enough, completing. He wins the battle. He'll bring the walls down. But what do? We give a shout of praise as the priests blast the trumpets. Now, the type of blast instructed to the people on the ram's horn is a very specific blast. It is a blast that has an instruction. The instruction of the type of trumpet blast, the way to blow, was literally to blast the trumpet 9 short, sharp times. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Now, interestingly, this is a language given to this blast, and it is the horn of victory. It declares victory. But you know what's so interesting? It sounds like ba 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 ba. 9 gifts of the Spirit. When we talk about tongues, it is literally the sword of the Spirit. It sounds just like the blast of victory given as an instruction to the people with the ram's horn. You know, you can't speak in tongues without the finished work of Jesus. Right? So through the gospel, we speak in a tongue we don't understand that is for us victory that goes ahead, that cuts away, like Tara was saying. We literally cut at the enemy. And this is the blast given as the instruction to the people of Israel before they give a shout of praise. So don't use your mouth to speak cynicism, to speak negative things. No, use your mouth to pray in tongues, and your blast of victory, your horn of victory is going out. 9 gifts of the Spirit, 9 short, sharp blasts. Can you see the pattern? It's all in us enforcing the finished work of Jesus. The battle being the Lord's is truly about us taking our place in faith, in response to enter into that promised land, in response to the gospel, to enter into what God has for us. But by literally going, God, I've got to get on your side. I want to be on your side. You know, when people look at you and they say to you, how can you just serve? Or how can you not enforce yourself, your opinions, your ideas? Even in my life, the way to see the Lord move mightily is to actually lower that I have to have my way. I surrender it and I just say, Lord, it's an honor and a privilege to be able to see you in your majesty, God, what you've done for me is so amazing. What an honor and a privilege to be alive, to be on this earth at this time. And as I see myself as not so significant in the story, but Jesus as my Savior as what's significant, my faith rises up. And in response to the fact that my God has given me a promised land, I go, declaring his gospel, speaking in tongues, and literally entering rest. Rest, that stress, anxiety, that is not part of the promised land living. It is entering his rest. There remains a rest for the people of God because Joshua said there will come a day, right? And Joshua says, for he who has entered his rest himself has ceased from his work as God has from his. Therefore, let's be diligent. Let's enter this. Look at verse 12. For the word of God is living and powerful and is sharper than any two-edged sword. So it is likening rest and entering this as literally the word of God being declared. You know, often when I believe we pray in tongues, I believe we're also speaking the word of God over our lives. And we're speaking according to heaven's pattern, not our earthly agenda. When I don't know what to pray, I pray in tongues because God prays perfectly through me, for me, with me. So you're lifting up the word of God, declaring the word of God, and it literally pierces the division of the soul and the spirit, the joint and the marrow. It's literally going out, going. What I love about this is the plan is not a plan. Until you step back and you see the pattern of the plan. The pattern of the plan was to make Jesus take on that battle and rest be entered into and the gospel be declared and tongues be spoken. The battle was not about how great is the army of Israel. They didn't have a battle plan, but actually the battle plan was to let the Lord fight the battle. Your life cannot be a testimony of the goodness of God if it's about the goodness of you. We should never boast in and of ourselves. In fact, the Bible says if you have anything to boast in the fact that how the Lord uses someone like this for his glory. Boast in your weakness because it is his strength. The battle is the Lord's. And the beautiful thing though is we enter into a promised land living. I really believe the Church of Jesus Christ is entering into a promised land living where it enforces the land Jesus has purchased for us. From Jericho, Israel thrive. From the promised land, the church thrives. Not in our own work, but in enforcing and lifting up and pointing to the work of our Lord and Savior. But yet, full of faith, saying yes to everything God is calling us to. Yes, yes, Lord. Yes, I come. Yes, I follow. Yes, we go. Yes, anything is possible. Every battle, we will be the victors because our Lord and Savior, he literally shows up and is on the side of himself, which enforces the victory. Today, wherever you're watching from, I want to speak to your situation. I want to declare the battle is the Lord's. Let it be the Lord's. Line your life up with the word of God. Don't think about emotion and feeling and what you're entitled to. If you're dealing with something and forgive, love, serve, sow, give, whatever it is in your life, line it up. Don't live in rebellion. Don't live lost in the wilderness. Don't live from your own agenda. Because it is robbing you of a promised land living for yourself. Fear not entering that rest. In other words, be very concerned when you live your life in disobedience to the word of God. Unsubmitted to the word of God. Let grace flow by lining your life up with his goodness. It's not even about you having to be powerful or important or successful. It is actually about you entering the rest of God, allowing grace to flow. It's so interesting because it actually says in Hebrews chapter 4, after it speaks about being diligent to enter rest and that the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword. Listen to this. It actually says here in verse 14, right? Seeing that we have a high priest, Jesus, who's passed through the heavens, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession, right? For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, but was in all points tempted and yet was without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to this throne of grace. Today, if you've missed it, if your life isn't lining up with the word of God, don't try to fix it in your own strength. Run to a sympathizing, empathizing high priest who has understood what you've gone through. Maybe you've been hurt and you've left, or you've been disappointed and you've walked away, or maybe somebody's hurt you, some person's hurt you. Maybe you've been living in fear with whatever it is in your life, right? Come to the throne of grace boldly. Why? Because your God knows what you've gone through, and he wants to give you mercy and allow you to find grace in this time of need. Never try and live your life in your own strength. That's just going to lead to more and more losses, no victories. Bring it back to this throne of grace, knowing that you're accepted, you're loved, and God is calling you home today. If your life doesn't line up with the word of God, run to that throne of grace. Your condemnation, your judgment has already been paid for. Don't let the devil sit and go, but they, but them, but what are they going to say? What is this person going to think? Respond in faith to the grace of God being poured out, because you have We have limited time on this earth. We're not going to live forever. And we need to line up with the purpose of God, because we will not possess the promised land as long as we're living in rebellion, as long as we're living lost, led by our feelings, led by our emotions, led by our fears. No, line up with the word of God, full in faith, respond to him. Come running to this throne of grace so that he can release the grace of God powerfully over you. And what will happen? You line up to take on the promised land. God wants you to take a promised land and enter his rest for yourself. That's what you're going to do. So wherever you're watching right now, firstly, I want to pray for people who don't know Jesus Christ. And I want everybody else to stay till we're done with the sermon, because God's going to speak to you powerfully on other areas. But firstly, those who don't know Jesus Christ, right now, here's your opportunity to say yes to Jesus. Receive this grace. Let it flow. Let the saving power of Jesus line you up with the word of God so that you can enter this promised land, this rest that he has for you, and literally give your battle to God. Whatever it is, whatever it's for, every battle God wants to take on for you. So if you've never prayed the prayer of salvation before in your life, right now, I'm going to lead you in it. Wherever you're watching, in whatever language you're watching it in, pray this prayer with me. Receive salvation today. Your life will never be the same again. Simply repeat after me. Say, Lord Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for me. By your body that was broken, your blood that was shed, all my sin, past, present, and future, has been paid for in full. Today I declare, you are my Lord, you are my Savior. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Now, if you prayed that prayer for the very first time, wherever you're watching all around the world, the information at the bottom of the screen is so that you can tell us you prayed this prayer for the very first time. We want to celebrate with you, and we want to bless you with a whole bunch of resources about Jesus. We want to be able to send you a whole bunch of good things telling you more about the decision you made today. So wherever you're watching, in either comment below in the social media pages where you're watching, Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, wherever you're watching, let us know. I prayed that prayer for the first time. We want to celebrate with you, and we're so honored to walk towards the promised land with you today. Now, I want to pray for each and every single person here today, where the Lord has spoken a word over you and has declared for you the promised land he has for you. Maybe the Lord himself has highlighted areas in your life that need to be brought back to this throne of grace, that need to be surrendered unto him. Maybe you've had brokenness, hurt relationships, disappointments, whatever has gone on, right? Through whatever has happened, God doesn't want you living there from brokenness, in a wilderness. He wants you living from his promised land of rest in victory. So I want to pray over you today. Father, I thank you for each and every single person watching this. God, your church has a promised land to enter, has a place of rest and provision and supernatural productivity, that we will reign on this earth from receiving your grace. We will see our lives be a testimony of your glory. I thank you for each and every single person watching that might be discouraged and might feel like they've been disqualified, or that they've missed it, or they've left. God, allow them to to receive this grace that humbles them and brings them back into alignment with your word. Father, I want to speak a supernatural repentance over our people, that they line up with your word and they aren't interested in their own agendas and their own wills and their own hurts. But God, you show them there's a greater way to live from a promised land. Surrendered to you, Lord Jesus, even in my life, Lord, and our leadership's life. Lord God, thank you for this grace that brings us through correction into alignment with you. It's not our will, Lord, but your will. It's not our church, but your church. It's not our strength. It's not our talent and our skills. It's you, Lord. And thank you for this honor and this opportunity and this privilege to be a part of being used by you. Each and every single person watching today says yes, Lord God, leans in and receives that fresh perspective of a promised land living in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to receive communion together right now, church. So if you can, just take out your communion elements, the bread and the juice. I really feel like God is breaking something fresh in us, releasing something powerful in us. And I feel like we as a church are going into such a precious place where we will be used powerfully by God. And as we do that, you know, the enemy freaks out and he panics, but we have the battle-winning victory. We have the work of our Lord and Savior. And today, Lord Jesus, we declare over this bread, the body of Jesus, that every sickness, every disease, every attack on our homes, on our bodies, is rendered to naught, is totally dealt with by the suffering of our Savior. We declare that by the body that was broken by Jesus, this body of his own broken for us, we are healed. As we break this, we receive healing and wholeness. We declare disease leave in Jesus' name. Sickness leave in Jesus' name. You will have no authority in our homes and our bodies. The blood of Jesus, this is so powerful. The blood of Jesus says we have a throne that our God sits on, full of grace. God has judged every sin, every shortcoming. Every time you've messed up, every time we've gone right when we should have gone left, has been paid for in full by Jesus. So now we can come boldly to God in need and know that we'll receive grace. So we declare the blood of Jesus shed for us takes care of every sin, every failing, every shortcoming. And in faith, in response to the good news of the gospel, we always come back to you, God, knowing there is grace that is sufficient for us. We receive the blood of Jesus as a seal of our sanctification and holiness. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Wow, I'm so excited for what God is doing. I want to speak to you about finance. The question is not what is going to go on with our currency? What is going to go on with our work? What is going to go on with COVID? What is going to go on with world trade? What is going to go on with interest rates? The question is, have you asked the Lord to lead your finances? Have you placed your finances on his side? The tithe is about breaking the pride in humanity saying, I know how to make myself rich. The tithe is about actually understanding when Abraham says to Sodom, I'm not going to give you my tithe. I'm giving it unto Melchizedek because it is he who made me rich. God wants you never to carry the burden of your own provision. But you know what? Our pride often says, I can do it. I should do it. I will do it. I want to encourage you, church. Let's not ask the question, whose side is God on? Let's ask the question, have we brought the Lord into our finances? The tithe is totally about saying to the Lord, you, your strength, your wisdom, your leading is responsible for my provision. The battle for financial provision is the Lord's, and our tithe declares that. Our tithe enforces that. So I want to encourage you to trust in God and allow yourself to tithe, not out of fear, but in faith that he's our provider. And so today as we give of our tithe, and I want to encourage you, if you've never done it before, there's no rest over your finances until you trust the Lord with your tithe. That is the promised land living, enforcing the work of Jesus over your finances. As you give today, as you get involved with your finance in the Lord, we know that there is a supernatural rest that comes into our homes. Father, I thank you for each and every single person, Lord Jesus, that as you grow them to be stewards of finances. You grow them to grow in wisdom and impact for your glory, Lord Jesus, that we never receive the burden of provision, that actually we place the burden of provision on you. And Father, I thank you as we tithe today, we set aside our finances, set unto you, protected by you, declared holy by you. As we do so, Lord Jesus, not in fear, but in faith, not out of manipulation, but revelation, we know you are our heavenly provider, supernaturally pressed down, shaken together, pouring out of the windows of heaven. Your blessing is ours. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And as you've received today, be blessed. Know that God is on your side. The battle is the Lord's. And as a church, we're prophetically going into a promised land. Until we see you again, as you respond with your giving, have an incredible week, church. We love and appreciate you. Be blessed. Now we stand at the water.